I am honored, as I always am every year, and humbled, and I mean that, with your faith in me and the work that we do at the national level right across the country. I wanted to say thanks to so many people. I want to say thank you to the Nanaimo chapter, and particularly for your success in getting the Blue Communities passed here. It's just wonderful. Thank you to Pina and Gary John for Fred chairing this morning, to Donna and the team for the incredible amount of work that went into this. Thank you to Gary Neal and the entire staff of the Council of Canadians, which is the most awesome group of people I've ever worked with. Thank you to the chapters, thank you to the members, and thank you to the board of directors. This is an organization of so many dedicated people, and I just have no way. People say thank you to me, and I say no, I turn around and say it back to you. We could not do our work, I could not do my work, if we didn't have this infrastructure, and it's so important at this political moment. I wanted to say a couple of housekeeping things. One is about the new rule changes that we were discussing this morning that are causing anxiety. They're causing anxiety to me too, I want you to know that. This is imposed on us, this is not something that we have introduced because we have nothing else to do with our lives. And we're trying to figure out a way to do it that respects those members who don't want their names to be made public. So we're trying to look at the way to do this. I assure you we're not using it to in any way change the structure or take power away from anyone. I mean, I think we're one of the most open groups in I've ever known about. I mean, anyone on the board, any of the campaigners, the organizers, any of the chapters, anybody basically who has got a role with us can speak on behalf. And that includes the board of directors can speak on behalf of the Council of Canadians, both publicly and in the media. And there aren't many organizations that have that kind of trust, and we do, and we're not going to change that. So let's figure that out together, how we take these rules, which I don't trust, I don't like why they're doing it, I fear for it. And I fear that, that you could get somebody or some people joining just to find out who we are and who our members are. You should know that on this robo-challenge that we've got going, Conservative Party of Canada's lawyers, the first thing they did was submit a 750-page affidavit just blasting us, and me in particular, going after the board. Some of our board members are union members, union leaders. It's a terrible thing. And they called me a wanton and officious interloper. I didn't give it to them, of course, but this is what we need to think about in terms of where all of this is going. So, but just to tell you, we're aware of the stress that this is causing. On the issue of the deficit, we're not alone. Absolutely every organization that's dependent on membership is going through this kind of crisis. Organizations that are dependent on foundations have found that the money isn't there anymore in the way that it was after the economic downturn of a few years ago. And also the political pressure for those groups not to give money to change agents like us. If it's charitable work, you can get all the money you want. If you want to dig a well in Africa, you can find all the money you want. If you want to question the lack of justice in that country and why people there don't have clean water because of our mining companies perhaps in this case, you can't get money from a foundation. It's just that much harder. So, and I think we need to recognize the political moment in terms of what the Harper government is doing to non-governmental organizations, to civil society groups. If you have charitable status, they are going after you in every conceivable way. We decided years ago not to even try to seek charitable status. We knew the day would come when we would want to be independent. And it was a struggle, no question about it, but it is very important that we have that that non-status now, that we have the independence that we have. This means that in the face of all these groups either getting their funding pulled or their charitable status pulled or being careful, I was at a meeting of a group of people around mining, the shout-out on mining injustice, and a woman from one of the major environmental groups said, you know, there's a chill on us and we're afraid to speak out because we just don't know how they're going to come after us and how they're going to get us. So I would say to us, to all of us collectively, that the role of the Council of Canadians is more important than it's ever been. Because of this chill effect that we're dealing with, that we simply have to be here to speak out where others are not able to speak out with those that are able to, like our union allies and colleagues. But it's really very, very important that we exist. And I'm not a religious person, but I do deeply believe in the parable of the loaves and the fishes. And that is, if we do the work, we'll find the funds, we'll find the resources. And we can't say, well, we can't do the work because we don't have the funds. For my entire adult life, that has been the way I have operated. We'll find the funds. If it has to be done, it'll come to us, and we'll find the resources. And I don't know where, and I know, bless her, that this wonderful Mary Moore gave us funding this year, came in this year, that has stopped that deficit from being so great. But there will be others who care enough about what we're doing, and I just know that we will find the resources we need to keep our work going. I also want to say thank you to the BC chapters, to the British Columbia activists. This tour has been fabulous. It goes on. We're in Smithers tomorrow night and Prince George the night after. And I just want to say that I've become deeply committed to this pipeline fight. I was committed in my head before. I'm committed in my heart now. I really, really don't want these pipelines to be destroyed. I want to say that in British Columbia, there's another fight that I want. I know there are so many, so don't get me wrong. I'm not choosing one over the other, but we need to cast our eyes northeast to the shale fracking that's going on in that area. We met this lovely, lovely young Aboriginal leader, Caleb Benn, you're going to hear more about his voice. He comes from northeastern British Columbia, and he tells us about work camps with 1,000 men in them. They're just there taking the water massively because there just aren't enough people to watch and to bear witness, and there's certainly nobody to stop them. And we have pledged to him, and they've actually talked about us coming back at some point near the end of November for maybe some kind of a shout-out or collective action. So I'm not springing that on you, Brent, and well, sort of I am, and chatting with everybody, but I haven't even had time to stop and breathe and tell people what's happening. As we go through the province and as we do our work everywhere, we learn more and more and more about the solidarity that has to take place. And I just want to say once again, and I said it yesterday, the relationship that we're developing and have been for a long time, but I really feel is intensifying with First Nations communities, First Nations leaders, is just remarkable. I've watched over my lifetime of work how this trust, this bond of trust has been built. And I say full thanks to our team, the board and the staff and the organizers and everyone for the work that you've done cementing that, because I feel that trust growing. And when Grand Chief Stuart Phillip yesterday said that he was joining the Council of Canadians, he and Joan, that was just an absolutely pivotal moment in our organization and just a step forward that we have all collectively taken together. It was just a lovely and extraordinarily important moment. And I said it then and I mean it. It's not just that we're showing solidarity to First Nations, it's that we're recognizing their leadership and that they're following their leadership. Buses and ferries and all that stuff home, but I just want to say a couple of words about some of the campaign, the remarkable work we're doing. I said yesterday, and I say it again, on CETA, we put this issue on the map, and now QB has just taken it up and others, but this has been an absolutely incredible campaign that would have flown under the radar, I am absolutely convinced, had it not been for the tenacious work of the Council of Canadians and QB and others. And just to tell you that this morning's news is that Ed Fast, the trade minister, has said, well, now after all, when we said that this would be signed by the end of 2012, that was a guidepost, not a deadline. Turns out they're backing off, saying this is a deadline now. This has been absolutely airtight, right? One of the senior McLean's writers said that in a tweet, he said, there is Stephen Harper blaming Maude Barlow for the slowdown So people are watching and they know we have all these municipalities really on edge. We know the provinces have put a united front in saying they're in. We know that the work we've done has meant that the provinces are holding fast in some areas at the table. So we have caused a great distress, and we intend to continue to increase that distress as much as we can. On this foreign investment protection promotion agreement with China, there are hundreds of thousands of emails, calls, cards, whatever, going into members of parliament, and I think that you're going to see this is going to ramp up. And we are already working on a First Nations strategy, which we started talking to Chief Stuart Phillip yesterday, and our own Chief Gary John, and we've got that in the works too, because our good friend Art Manuel pointed out that this is a violation to not have any dialogue and not go through parliament. And not negotiate with First Nations is a violation of their treaty rights under 35.1 of the Constitution. So this work is moving steadily ahead. On healthcare, we are again in coalition with many others, very, very clearly there on the front lines. We've been at all the First Ministers' meetings, all of the healthcare meetings. The one in Halifax last time was wonderful. We've had puppets of all the premiers made, and we marched through the streets saying, you know, don't be a puppet to the federal government, fight back. And it was clear that we were heard. And my husband Andrew was sitting in the restaurant and heard a bunch of the young aides to the different ministers. And at one point somebody said, well, you can't put that in the statement, but Maude Barlow will go crazy. Yes, okay, if I'm a thorn in your side, or we are a thorn in your side, wonderful. On water, we're just doing so much. We've been part of a coalition that stopped the shipping of 16, now they're saying it would have been more, bus-size radioactive nuclear
waste.
Yes. To be shipped through the Great Lakes over to Sweden for recycling. And we worked again very closely with First Nations and small and local communities along the route, and it seems that we have, they won't admit that we've won on that, but those transactions are not taking place. We've launched a campaign to have the Great Lakes declared a public trust and a common heritage, and we were actually so thrilled to be invited to speak to the International Joint Commission and all of the staff, and they asked us for 45 minutes. We were there for an hour and a half, and it was just absolutely tremendous. And in their international meeting or gathering a couple of months ago, Waterkeeper International, led by Robert Kennedy Jr., fully endorsed our position on water of the Great Lakes as a public trust and a common heritage. So this was a very exciting development for us, only one of many on that front. Since the United Nations have recognized the human right to water and sanitation, we've been working with communities around the world to have domestic plans put together. But I just, as a few examples, Bolivia, Mexico, India, El Salvador, the EU, even California and the Vatican have passed, either changed their constitutions or passed laws recognizing the human right to water and sanitation. So there's just unleashed an amazing amount of domestic movement on this issue. We continue to work in solidarity internationally. We had that wonderful shout out on mining injustice here in Vancouver in British Columbia in May, and it was absolutely a stellar event that brought frontline, again, often First Nation, Indigenous, but also other impacted communities Canadian First Nations and environmentalists, anti-mining activists, human rights activists, and so on together. And the connections that we made and the powerful statements that were made, and there was hardly an hour that you would get through without being in tears to hear the courage of people whose communities are being attacked, who are being murdered. People are murdered, they're put in prison, they're tortured, they're disappeared, and they still come up smiling and say, we just move on, we lost that person, but we move on as a group. And Grand Chief Philip talked about that in his remarks, and he was deeply moved by that, and I know that because I was with him several workshops and speeches that we heard together, and I could see that he was deeply moved. I was in Switzerland not long ago. We're supporting a fledgling movement to fight Nestle right in the heart of Nestle itself, right in the heart of Switzerland, its own country. I mean, it's just, this is an awful corporation in many ways, but I will just tell you the reason that we want to ramp this up is that they're now setting themselves on all the important advisory bodies at the World Bank, at the United Nations, and so on, even within national governments, to develop the next generation of policy around water. This is a company that knows nothing about delivering water sanitation. They take water out of the ground, put it in bottles, and ship it around the world, but they have sold themselves as the leader of water conservation and water delivery around the world. And so we are setting ourselves up against them, and just a lovely small victory, but a big one for us, because they are just untouchable in Switzerland, is that Peter Brabeck, the CEO, was supposed to get an award and have a big speaking engagement at one of the universities. And one of the profs and a group of his students came not once but twice to hear me when I was there. They led a movement to have the university cancel Peter Brabeck's. This is the company that goes after the 13-year-old girl in Ontario, Arthur Robin Hanlon, who was so devoted to this issue that she's gone to, I think, something like 18 municipalities.
I filmed her
in Kingston to have.
It's on the Simcoe Region chapter.
Either ban bottled water or adopt themselves as a blue community. And so they've started taking off after and writing letters to the municipalities saying, why would you listen to a 13-year-old girl? This is like, pick on somebody your own size. Pick on me. You take me on, but leave that kid alone. Anyway, she's tough as nails, so they can. She's more than a match for them. We're very excited about the work that we're doing, supporting the applicants who are charging that they believe there was electoral fraud in their ridings. This is heating up now. It's going to be coming to court in December. We are expecting that it will go to the Supreme Court, and it's been an extremely wonderful experience to go through. It's been very hard. Our lawyer, Stephen Schreibman, is working 24/7. That's why he's not here this weekend. It's been a vicious assault on the personalities and reputation of people like Frank Graves, who used his polling expertise to get us background information that we're able to use that we, in a way that we believe shows that there was indeed fraud. So we're in a very nasty fight, and I can tell you, I can see by what the other side is trying to do or is doing, that we're up against people who are ruthless. I mean, we keep saying to the media over and over again, if they care at all they should care about is getting to the heart of the truth here. That's all we're asking for. We're not charging anybody with anything. And if you care, and you say you care, Stephen Harper, about this, help us get to the truth. But there's none of that. And then just finally to say that we're launching in the new year a new coalition, we don't know what it's going to be called yet, some kind of common cause, that came out of a September 13th meeting in Ottawa with all national organizations from all the sectors. And I won't name them all because then I'll leave some out, but we're really pulled together a vast sector from, you know, the Canadian Labour Congress to grassroots Occupy, environment, labour, human rights, women, culture. We brought together a very powerful group of groups, and we are going to be launching a fight back against the Harper agenda.